Again, not sure on what your week has been like. I don't know how you found this, but I'm certainly aware for us that there's that kind of feeling of, oh, January was long, wasn't it? Christmas was busy. Summer feels like a long, long time ago. And it's all just a little bit. And so we've found that in our home. I don't know if that's been perhaps your experience as well. So if that helps you to focus and just keep on track a little bit this morning, then do that. We've been looking at the book of Acts. If this is your first time with us, let's catch you up. We've been looking at the book of Acts over these past few weeks. We were looking at it the first half last year. We're going to continue through the rest of it into this year. So we're at Acts 16 today. And this series has been called Movement, Momentum and Multiply. Because we've been seeing how this movement of Jesus, this thing about Jesus dying on the cross and rising again for the forgiveness of sins, this thing that we call the gospel, has been spreading from initially 11 disciples who are face to face with the risen Jesus to 120 followers gathered together in one room when the Holy Spirit comes, to now spreading across the ancient world. And this had never happened before. This was a brand new thing in any context at that time for something that could come across and cross economic boundaries and racial boundaries. And this gospel has gone out to everyone. Jesus says, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. And as this gospel has spread, more and more people are responding to it. There is momentum to it. And the number of people who are now following Jesus is multiplying. Movement, momentum, and multiplying. And we see it throughout the book of Acts. A little catch up, the book of Acts is written by a guy called Luke. Luke's profession was a doctor, in case you didn't know that one. He was a doctor, and the book itself is often called the Acts of the Apostles, but a more accurate understanding would probably be the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Because at the very start of the book of Acts, we have the Holy Spirit coming to the disciples. And then throughout the rest of the book, we just see how the Holy Spirit is at work. How the Holy Spirit is leading and guiding and at work in people's hearts. And we see that particularly in what we've got this morning. We see it as Paul and Silas and Timothy are heading off on their second missionary journey. The mission is set for them. They know what they've got to do. They're going to go and tell people about Jesus. That's their vision. That's their aim. That's what they're going for. And they're just going to follow God's Spirit as they do that. We are about 21 years on now from when the Holy Spirit first came by chapter 16. It doesn't feel like that when you're kind of reading it in your Bible in a year plan, does it? You kind of flick through a few chapters and all of a sudden it's like 21 years has passed in 16 chapters. If you go back to chapter 14, which is when Paul and Silas and Timothy were last in this place called Derbe and Lystra, which we'll find out about in just a moment. 5 years has gone in those two chapters. We've gone 5 years since then. Acts chapter 16, verses 1 to 15. Shall I read them for us? I'll pray, and then we'll spend some time getting stuck into this. He came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was a Jewess, and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they travelled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by the apostles and the elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in number. Paul and his companions travelled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. So they passed by Mysia and went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight to Samothra at Thrace, and the next day to Neapolis. From there we travelled to Philippi, a Roman colony and the leading city in that district of Macedonia, and we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath we went outside the city gate to the river, where we expected to find a place of prayer. We sat down and began to speak to the women who had gathered there. One of those listening was a woman named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth from the city of Thyatira, who was a worshipper of God. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. When she and the members of her household were baptized, she invited us into her home. "If you consider me a believer in the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my house." And she persuaded us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the way it can speak to us today, the way that we can see you at work through it. And as Mark prayed earlier, Lord, we do ask that you would open our hearts, that we might hear from you this morning. That you might open our ears to hear what it is that you want to say to us today, whether that be an encouragement, a challenge, whatever it is that we need, Lord, whatever it is that you have in store for us, help us not to miss it this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So the gospel has spread like wildfire. This news of Jesus has been flowing throughout the ancient world, and the believers have gone from just a few hundred to thousands. Thousands of people now knowing Jesus and wanting to follow him. It is a radical, radical movement. Just have a, if we can pop the map up for us, if that's on there, let's have a look. So this is a map that Jonathan showed us last week when we were thinking about what happens when Christian falls out, fall out, and how we deal with that. But I wonder if you could just, what I'm going to try and do, what I want you to do is a bit of a challenge. It's to stare at that map for long enough that you can remember it for about a second. So if you look at it long enough, you will see the red bit in the middle, which is Asia, not China, but Asia Minor, get my words out. Then you'll see to the top of that in light green, you've got Bithynia. Can you see that on there? Yeah? And then, can you see, it's a bit difficult to see actually on there, but there is the tiny city dot on there of Ephesus, which is just to the bottom left of Asia. And what I like to do is try and keep a fix on that. You've then got the purple part as well, where it says Thrace and Macedonia. You want the orange bit is Macedonia. Okay, that's where we're going to end up in today's part of the Bible. You got that for long enough? Now, if we switch to the next map really, really quickly, hopefully you'll be able to remember that. Okay. Is that blending in okay? I couldn't find a map that had everything I wanted on it, and I wasn't going to be able to try and create one myself because that's not my gifting. But here we go. So, you'll hopefully see on there Lystra and Derbe to the south of Galatia, there on South Galatia. Lystra and Derbe, that's where Paul and Timothy and Silas are at. Paul's gone back there after 5 years of being away to see how the church is getting on. He's found out that in the last 5 years, there is a young man by the name of Timothy who has risen up within the church. And in that church, the people speak really well of him. They talk really, really highly of Timothy. He's well spoken of, and they think he is a really sound guy. And Paul goes, you know what? I need someone like Timothy on my team. I need someone like Timothy who's going to come with me and help me share Jesus with other people. And so Timothy joins Paul's team. But he has to do something first. You might have spotted that in there, which seemed a little bit strange. He says, I want Timothy to come with me. But Timothy's mother was a Jew, but his father was a Greek, which meant that Timothy would not have been circumcised. Now, there is nothing, as we've seen in chapter 14 a little bit earlier, there is no need to be circumcised to be okay with God anymore. Jesus has sorted all of that out. But still, Paul says, Timothy, you need to get circumcised. Why did he do that? Well, it tells us here, because of the Jews in that area. The Jews in that area, when they went to the temple, were not going to listen to anything Timothy had to say. They would be more concerned about his heritage. And Paul says, look, you know what? I don't want people thinking about that when we get there. I don't want people worrying about where you came from and who your father was. So let's just deal with this. Let's just get that out of the way so we can tell them about Jesus. Let's just remove the barrier so that we can tell them the gospel. So there's nothing in there about Timothy needing to do that to sort out his salvation or to sort out his standing with God. That's just so the barriers are removed so that he can share Jesus when he gets to the temple. I had to work really, really hard to not make any awkward or unnecessary kind of comments that could be misinterpreted through that. You did well to keep straight faces. Thank you very much. Catch up a little bit. 5 years since Paul was last in Lystra and Derbe in chapter 14. Paul's focus continues to be sharing the gospel. That's all he wants to do. That's his mission. That's his aim. There's nothing else in it. Just tell people about Jesus. And this is the second journey now that he's gone on to try and do this. Question for us this morning, though. Question for you as we sat here this morning. How do you make your big decisions? How do you make your big decisions? When those times come and you're thinking, okay, what do I do when it comes to moving house? What should I do about my job? What do I do about my exam choices, subjects I'm going to be studying going forward? Relationships. What do we do with our big decisions? How do we make them? I wonder if, I'd hope that for those of us here who are following Jesus, we would say, well, we pray. We'll start by praying. Let's get stuck in and see if God might lead us and guide us. Maybe we'll talk to Christian friends. Perhaps we'll talk to other friends. Perhaps you're the kind of person who doesn't really think this stuff through too much. You just kind of go with the flow and just see what happens and just push some doors and see where it ends up. But how do you make your big decisions in life? Well, we're going to see that for Paul and Timothy and for Silas, as they journey, they journey and they want to tell people about Jesus and share this gospel message, we're going to see how God is continually leading them every step of the way. And it's not always how you think. It's not always the obvious ways. Sometimes there are ways that God works, but just a little bit different to how we might think. I wonder if you spotted that as you read that passage, as we went through that just now. Because as Paul and Timothy and Silas are journeying, it's the Holy Spirit who stops them from going to certain places. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, when it comes to sharing Jesus, I usually need Jesus' Spirit to say, go and tell people about Jesus. I need that kind of get out there and do it. Go and speak to that person, or be brave and just share your story in this moment. Not to stop me from doing it. And yet, with Paul and Silas and Timothy, we see that God stops them from sharing Jesus in certain places. But what we definitely see throughout this is the power of the Holy Spirit to guide Paul and his companions. The power of the Holy Spirit to guide them the whole time. Verses 6 to 10. Paul and his companions travelled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. That was kind of the south bit with Ephesus in it and the orange bit on the map, if you remember. And then they head north to Mysia, thinking they could head into Bithynia, which is the green bit at the top on that map, if you're keeping up with me. But again, the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. So they pass by Mysia. They go down to Troas, which was the port just opposite Macedonia. They head down there. During the night, Paul has a vision of a man from Macedonia standing and begging him, come to Macedonia and help us. After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the good news to them. The Holy Spirit is constantly leading them on their journey. But sometimes the Holy Spirit says no. He says that's not the place for you. Paul is thinking in his mind, let's head down to Ephesus. Ephesus is a massive city. Let's go down there. The Holy Spirit says no. You're not heading down there. Let's go up to Bithynia. Let's go and tell people up there about Jesus. The Holy Spirit says no, you're not going to that country either. So they go down to Troas and they get there. But sometimes God will say no in how he leads us and guides us. We don't know how the Holy Spirit said no to him. It could have been circumstances, it could have been illness, travel issues, it could have been a small voice, the roads were blocked, border control didn't let them in. You could pick and choose, really. Either way, though, they clearly identify it as being the Holy Spirit that says no. That's not where you're going. wonder what big dreams have you got? What are the things that you're wanting to do? What are the things that perhaps you even feel God has put on your heart to do? Sometimes you might say no. And that, I don't know about you, but that can be really hard. That can be really difficult. No is not a comfortable answer for us, I don't think. I don't think it's something you ever grow out of. I don't know if you try to say no to a young child who wants one more snack before dinner or wants 5 minutes more TV time. If you've ever tried that, it's not a pretty sight sometimes. And there's part of me that feels that sometimes we're all big kids deep down. And when someone says no, or particularly if God says no, it doesn't sit right. And we can have those moments where we just find that a little bit uncomfortable. But we need to trust that God does know what he's doing and that God does see the big picture. Sometimes God will guide us by saying no. Sometimes he will guide us by saying wait. And we say, oh, you've got all of them there, that's fine. Sometimes he will guide us by saying wait. Paul wanted to go down to Ephesus to start off with, and Jesus says no. In fact, he says no, not yet. Because if you skip forward, no spoiler alert for a few weeks' time, but if you skip forward to Acts chapter 19, we'll find out that Paul does eventually get to Ephesus. But God says you need to take the long way round first. Anyone seen the long way round? Ewan McGregor, Charlie Borman? Anyone? If you haven't seen it, that's a great show. That's well worth watching. A complete sidetrack for a moment, it came to mind. But if you haven't seen The Long Way Round with Charlie Borman and Ewan McGregor, I recommend it highly. It's brilliant. Anyway, God says to Paul, you need to take the long way round to get to Ephesus because I've got something else in store for you first. I've got somewhere else I want you to go first. You're thinking you want to go down to a city in Ephesus. I'm saying, wait, that's not for you yet. And sometimes with us, God is going to say, just wait. Now's not quite the right time. Just hold on. Just wait and see. He'll always be guiding. He'll always be leading. Sometimes he might say no. Sometimes he might say wait. Paul heads down to Troas, follows God's leading down there, in whatever way that might have been, and he has this vision of a Macedonian man at night time saying, come and help us. We don't know how Paul knew that he was Macedonian. Perhaps he had a Macedonian football shirt on or something like that. We're not quite sure. But he knows this guy's from Macedonia. And he knows that this is God saying, come and help us. Come and help us. Because sometimes God will guide us by also saying yes. Sometimes he will say yes. I don't think that this particular verse here is a place to get stuck into the theology of dreams or visions and how God works through those. But simply to see that God has got this journey mapped out from the very start. God knows what the plan is. And for Paul and Silas and Timothy, they just need to keep following it. They just need to keep listening to him, keep on walking, keep on praying, and follow what God has called them to do. I wonder if you spotted, though, as we've read through it, it took me a couple of readings to actually see this, but as they leave Asia, as Paul and Silas and Timothy are heading off from the port of Troas to head over to Macedonia, did you spot the language change in verse 9, I think it might have been. He goes from saying in verse 6, let's say, he says this, Paul and his companions travelled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia. Skip forward to verse 11. Luke starts saying, from Troas, we put out to sea and sailed to Samothrace. Do you see who now has joined the journey? Luke's now with them. It was Paul and his companions, but now Luke has joined in as well. At the port of Troas, Luke's joined the party. Now we've got Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke all setting out to sea and sailing across towards Neapolis and over to Philippi. Luke joins the journey. Now, God could have said to Paul, right back in Derby, go straight to Troas. Head straight down there, and then you're going to go to Macedonia, and you're going to go to Philippi, and you're going to go and speak to some people over there. No. Paul follows the steps. God puts all the people in the right place, just to meet up at just the right time, to then head over to Macedonia. Dr. Luke now joins Paul Again, we're not told particularly why. There's a good theory going on this, though, that if Luke is a doctor and Paul is getting beaten and stoned quite a lot for talking about Jesus, to have your own personal physician is not a bad shout, really, is it? That's kind of a useful thing to have. And who knows, perhaps that's exactly why God put those people together at just that time. That Paul would have a companion in the gospel and someone who could look after him physically as well. But the point is, God knew. God knew the timings. God knew the people. God knew the place. And Paul just had to keep following him on that journey. It was just the right moment for them to come together. And then good old Paul, who's been desperate to get to a city, whether it be up in Bithynia or over in Ephesus, God says, you know what, Paul? I'm not going to send you to a city. I'm going to send you to an entirely new continent that needs Jesus. You're going to head overseas, and you're going to tell this entire continent who don't know the gospel, you're going to tell them about Jesus. Isn't that incredible? There's Paul thinking, I'm going to go to the city, and God's like, no. I've got a whole continent lined up for you. Reminds you of Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. It might come up on the screen as well. And I wonder if you can fill this in without having the blanks needed up there, but it's a popular verse. If this isn't a memory verse for you yet, i.e. if you haven't learned this in your minds, then you probably didn't go to Sunday school. But this one worth learning. This is worth just having in the bank, isn't it? Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. If that's not a massive reassurance to you, if you're at a crossroads in your life at the moment, I don't know what is. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. I wonder if Paul had that in mind when he gets to the border of Asia and they say, no, you're not telling us about Jesus. Or when he gets to Bithynia and they say, no, you're not coming in here to talk about the gospel. I wonder if Paul sat there going, okay, I don't understand that. I don't understand, God, why you wouldn't want me to go up there. But I'll trust you. I'll take the next step. I'll see what it might be. The power of the Holy Spirit to guide us. And God will guide us by saying no. He'll guide us by saying yes. And he'll guide us by saying wait. The second thing that we see here really clearly, I think, in these last few verses is the power of the Holy Spirit to save. It's the power of the Holy Spirit to save. Verse 14 particularly, as the gospel reaches Europe, Paul and his co pull up on the shores of Macedonia. It's the Sabbath. They've been dotted around. They've gone to the city. They're thinking, let's head to the city. Their usual kind of MO was head to the temple. There'll be some Jews in the temple to talk about Jesus with. They get there. They find out there is no temple. Why is there no temple? Well, because there's not even 10 Jewish men in the city. If there's 10 Jewish men in the city, there would be a temple. That was the law. There'd have to be a temple there. But there's not. And so Paul says, okay, well, what should we do? Let's go and find a place of prayer. Let's head down outside the city and go to the river. Let's go on the riverbanks and find a place to pray. And so they do that. And they get there, and there's some women down there. So what they do when the women are down there? They talk about Jesus. It's kind of what they're trained in. It's what they're there for. That's what they want to do. They start sharing Jesus in this place, and they're looking out, and they can see that this woman, Lydia, perhaps, in the crowd, is just her eye contact is saying she's really taking this in, perhaps. She's really going for it. She's like, actually, tell me more about this, Jesus. This is amazing. And they get there. And Lydia, it was told, the Spirit opens her heart to respond to the message. Where was the Holy Spirit at work? In the heart of Lydia on a riverbank outside the city of Philippi. Not in a city centre, not a big mission event, not in some beautiful building, not like an organised visitation plan, a simple riverbed where there's a lady and some others. A lady of wealth and influence. Purple is an expensive cloth. That's like the Gucci or the Versace of the day. If you wore purple, then you were doing well. That was a real kind of high-end class thing. And so this lady, Lydia, she's not going to be short of a few quid. She's doing well for herself. But it's her that God had called Paul to go and speak to. It didn't look glamorous. Didn't look flashy. Didn't look amazing. Just a simple riverbed. But that's where God was at work. And that was where God brought change. Not just for Lydia, but her entire household. We see the whole family are baptized. Humble Christians just following God, wanting to share the good news that Jesus is Lord. And that authority on heaven and earth has been given to him. And they will share that, whether it's a temple or whether it's a riverbed. They will share that news. They wanted to go to the city. God says, no, I'll give you a continent. But you've got to start by taking just the next step. God's plans are always bigger than ours are going to be. God's plans are always going to be bigger than ours. I don't see any runners amongst us this morning, or perhaps listening online. There might be a few of them. If you run around Woodbridge, perhaps, then you may have come across a very small place called Drybridge Hill. Anyone come up against Drybridge Hill? A few of us have. I have the great joy of living not far from the top of Drybridge Hill, which means that when I go for a run, I head downhill first, and then when I get to the end of my run, I'm heading up the hill. And if I'm fancying a real challenge, I'll head towards Drybridge Hill. And I did it the other day, which if you see me limping later, that is why. It's probably the steepest hill there is in Woodbridge. And towards the end of my run, is it not now? I'm being told... Queenshead Lane, any advance on Queenshead Lane? North Lane, I feel like I'm an auctioneer again. It's taking me back to being 18. Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to try those out. I'm struggling with Drybridge Hill at the moment, but maybe I'll push towards that. But you know what I find really hard? If I get to the bottom of Drybridge Hill at the end of my run, and I look up, and I look right to the top, and I'm like, oh man, I'm not getting up there. Sometimes the kebab shop at the top is a bit of a temptation. That's sometimes motivation, but not always. I can't do it. If I'm looking at the very top of the hill, I can't do it. I've got to stick my head down. I've got to look at the next step. And I keep telling myself, if you ever see me running up it, and you see my face of pain, you'll know now that inside my head, all I'm saying is, take the next step. Take the next step. Take the next step. That's all I'm saying to myself the whole way through. And then before I know it, I'm at Bullard's Lane, which is the road near the top. You get a really awkward steep bit for the last 10 feet, and then you start to go over the top of it. But you just got to take the next step. You can't deal with it when you're looking at a whole thing from a distance. And sometimes God will just say to us, take the next step. Just take the next step, whatever that might be. Just take the next step. I had a great opportunity to listen to Terry Virgo speak recently. Terry Virgo is a guy who led New Frontiers movement of churches, which has become a global kind of network of churches now. And he said, they never set out to start a movement. They never set out to create a network or a movement of churches. All they ever did as a church to start off with, they just took whatever they felt the next step was that God wanted them to take. Just take the next step, whatever that might be, and know that God's Spirit will be at work. And he will be calling people. He'll be lining people up in just the right place. He'll be working in the hearts of the people that you meet. The colleague at work who you'd love to share the gospel with. The person on the school gate that you're just desperate with know Jesus. When they talk about all the struggles and troubles they're going through. Ian Bounds, who's a theologian from the 18-somethings, he wrote this. He said, it's better to speak to God about man than it is to speak to man about God. We need to be praying. It's better to speak to God about man than it is to speak to man about God. We need to be praying, but praise God, we can do both. We can pray and we can speak. And I will bet that the more you pray for people to come to the saving faith in Jesus, the more opportunities God will give you to share your faith in Jesus. The more you pray for opportunities, pray for people to come to saving faith in Jesus, the more opportunities God will give you to share your faith. The power of the Holy Spirit to guide, the power of the Holy Spirit to save. That's what we see here in Acts 16. God always leading, God always guiding, God always at work. God always being the one putting things into place at just the right time. I'm going to go for it. I've got about 3-4 minutes, I think. I'm going to share a little story with you, which is basically Acts 16 in a Bob Hartman version. Who knows Bob Hartman? Okay, so this is what the kids would get upstairs if I was doing this in kind of Sunday school upstairs in one of our kids groups. or if I was doing an all-age slot. I heard this story years and years and years ago. It's just a way of knowing and understanding at 16 the whole way through. I'm going to do this, and you're going to say, why don't you just do that at the start and sit down, guy? And next time, I will do that. That's fine. It goes like this, okay? You're going to join in with this. This is a bit of a chance to wake us up. So it's walked. That's it. Come on. You're with me now. Walked. Prayed. Listened. Okay, you ready? Walked. Prayed. Listened. Paul and Silas and Timothy were looking for a place to talk about Jesus. So they walked and they prayed and they listened. Day after day, week after week, they walked and they prayed and they listened. Uphill, downhill, across vast plains. You're following those actions as well. They walked and they prayed and they listened. And they came to the borders of the province of Asia as they walked and they prayed and they listened. But the Spirit of Jesus moved them on. So they walked and they prayed and they listened. Week after week, month after month, they walked and prayed and listened. And up those hills and down those hills, they walked and they prayed and they listened. And they came to the border of Mysia as they walked and they prayed and they listened. But the Spirit of Jesus moved them on, so they walked and they prayed and they listened. And they headed down to the port of Troas, as they walked and prayed and listened. And Paul had a dream of a man, as he walked and prayed and listened. Not sure he was walking, praying, listening whilst he dreamt, but that's how the story goes. Come talk to us, the dream man said, as you walk and pray and listen. Across the sea to Macedonia, come walk, and I'll pray that we'll listen. And so Paul and Silas and Timothy walked and prayed and listened. Across the sea to Macedonia, they walked and prayed and listened. And they spoke to the people, and the people believed, and churches were planted, and the good news was received. But it wouldn't have happened if they'd stayed at home, or got tired and quit, or made some great plan, or just did really whatever they wanted. Nope, it only really happened at all, because Paul and Silas and Timothy kept walking, kept praying, and kept listening. You can clap if you want. You don't need to clap. Whatever it is that's going on in your life or in your heart at the moment, just keep on going. Keep on walking with the Lord. Keep on praying and keep on listening. And He will direct your steps. He will guide you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that as we look at these words and we see how you're at work in the life of Paul and his friends as they traveled around wanting to share Jesus wherever you've put them, Lord, thank you that you are always at work and leading and guiding. And Lord, we thank you and praise you even more that that wasn't just restricted for them, but that is the same for us too today. That as we sit here, perhaps many of us going through different crossroads in our lives, not quite sure what's next or thinking about what the next right step is, Father, I pray that we would be able to trust you, that we wouldn't lean on our own understanding, that we would continue to acknowledge you and that you would direct our paths and make it clear. And whatever it might be, Lord, we pray that we would always be wanting to serve you and be living for your glory within those steps. That acknowledging you would mean, Lord, what do you want me to do? What's going to be the best thing for your kingdom? What's going to be the best thing for sharing the good news of Jesus? Would that be our motivation, Lord? Would that be our heart? Pray this in Jesus' name.